good morning and welcome. The psalmist bids us into the presence of God today with words that are honest and open and to some degree pleading of God. So hear these words from Psalm 126. God, our help in ages past, we recall today your deliverance. We remember the days of our salvation. What days they were. We wept with joy, we laughed, we sang, we couldn't believe our good fortune. We were the talk of the nations. You were wonderful to us then, and we relished your goodness. Oh God, do it again. Do it again. Bring rain to our drought-stricken lives. Dress our wounds and heal this land. While we plant seeds in soil that is dry, we believe for a harvest of abundance. We may weep today, but tomorrow we will shout your goodness to the ends of the earth. O God, our help, our strength, and our home. Would you stand with me as we sing, O God, our help in ages past. It is a real joy to welcome you here this morning. It is good to see old friends and new. To those who are gathered in the sanctuary and to those who are joining us online, we want to say to all of you, God's peace this morning. We learned with some concern just last night that our dear friend Catherine Jones has been called back to the UK quite suddenly. Her father is critically ill, and she is hopeful that she will make it in good time to be with him. And that is our prayer this morning for dear Kath and for Sean and for their family. These are difficult times for many, and sometimes those difficulties are exacerbated by distance and by the challenges we have faced over the last period of time in travelling. So we hold in prayers those who are affected by those situations. You know that this is the season of Lent, and this is the fifth Sunday in the season of Lent. Through the season of Lent, we are being guided in our worship by four symbols. Firstly, the symbol of the purple cloth, which is a symbol of our confession as followers of Jesus. The second is the symbol of the cross, a symbol of our commitment to follow. The third from last Sunday is the symbol of the candle, symbolic of our prayers, our longing to be close with God as we walk this journey to the cross. And today, our fourth and final symbol for these Sundays is the symbol of oil. Oil is a symbol of healing. We have been following the healing stories of Jesus in Luke's Gospel over these Sundays, and today we will continue that theme. The symbol of oil is a symbol both of the healing that we receive through our relationship with Jesus Christ, but also the healing ministry to which we are called and for which we are commissioned. And so it is in that sense that we gather our prayers today. I'm going to ask Gail Hill to come and join me at the front. It's an opportunity for me to say a very special welcome to Gail this morning. We have been exploring these healing stories of Jesus, and we've been doing so with many different perspectives. And today, we will be hearing a reflection on one of those stories, and we are very, very grateful to you, our friend, for joining us today. It is delightful to have you here. So would you now join us in prayer as we pray with this symbol before us? And when it comes to those words printed in bold italics, I would ask you to speak them out together and with confidence. Let us pray. God, our Creator, we rejoice today in the beauty and wonder of your world, for the earth that holds us, for the air we breathe, for the signs of life that flourish around us. God, our Creator, we give you thanks.
God, our Provider, we celebrate today every ounce of your goodness for the homes that shelter us, for the food we eat, for the people who love us and remind us of you.
God, our Provider, we give you thanks. God, our Redeemer, we acknowledge today our frailty and our failings. We confess our constant need of grace, renewal, and hope. God, our Redeemer, we confess our need of you.
God, our Healer, we receive today your compassion, your forgiveness, and your embrace. When our bodies ache, when our minds are clouded, and loneliness settles in.
God, our Healer, we rest in you. And God, our Saviour, as we follow Jesus to the cross, we long to be your vessels of healing in the world. Where there is pain, grant us what we need to ease the burden. Where there is anxiety, grant us words of peace. Where there is isolation, enable us to be a gentle presence. God, our Saviour, fill us with your Spirit. As we receive your healing in Jesus Christ, so we embrace your calling in our lives. Amen. Amen. Would you stand as we sing together? Give thanks with a grateful heart.
Because he's given Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. It is a delight to welcome Gail and Warren Hill with us today. You will know that Gail works for the Baptist Union of Victoria. Indeed, she is the head of all things, I hear, the head of mission, indeed. And Gail and Warren have been sneaking into the back row over the last little while, and part of us don't live too far from here. And I'm glad to entice Gail from the back row to the front this morning, and that she can share with us. But to both of you, peace, and thank you for being with us. I want to share the peace with you and say, the peace of the Lord be with you all. Let's stand and share that peace with those around us.
Good morning, everyone. For those who don't know me, I'm Robert Isles. I'm the Church Secretary, and it's my pleasure to endorse very briefly the welcome that Simon has already extended to you. Welcome also to our visitors and to Gail, and a particular welcome to those who are tuning into this service online. You'll be pleased that the announcements are mercifully short. There's a flyer in the narthex about our Lenten services. It's been there for a week or two, so please make sure you have one so that you're aware of the services over the Easter period. And there are some freebies at the end of the service for those who want some apples. There's a box of apples out on the veranda, and they're free. And if you want to avail yourself of some apples, feel free to do so. Let's prepare ourselves as we give thanks for our offering, be it given online, as the great majority of our church do, or those who wish to give here, and there are plates at the back of the church. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we come to you this morning aware of your call to us to be a people of gratitude and generosity. You call us to sing with gratitude in our hearts. We are grateful for life and all that it means to us, for home and friends, for the power to work and leisure to rest, for all that enriches thought and moulds our character for good, for all that is beautiful in creation and in the lives of others. We praise you, we give you our heartfelt thanks. But Father, we also know that you call us to generosity, to be rich in good deeds and to be generous and willing to share, following the example of your Son, our Lord. So that in obedience to your call, in recognition of your generosity to us, and indeed our compassion for those in need, both here and in so many other areas of this earth that sometimes seems shrouded in so much sadness, we offer both our financial gifts and indeed our lives to the service of your kingdom here on earth. Use both our gifts and us for that which is truly good. In the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Good morning. Our scripture reading this morning is from Luke chapter 18. And I'm not going to pretend to be a blind man in the first century Middle East, but I might try a little bit. As Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard a crowd going by, he asked what was happening. They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." Then he shouted, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Those who were in front sternly ordered him to be quiet. But he shouted even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and ordered the man to be brought to him. And when he came near, he asked him,
"What do you want me to do for you?"
He said, "Lord, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Receive your sight. Your faith has saved you." Immediately he regained his sight and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, praised God. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path.
Thank you, Nigel. That was really dramatic and really great, and I loved it. Maybe you should think about preaching at some stage. Okay, so in some ways, this story that we just heard is a metaphor for the Lenten season and Easter itself. It's a metaphor of grief, sorrow, and suffering, lament, perfectly depicted in what we now know and what we call Good Friday, the lament of Jesus, his suffering on the cross. But it contrasts with Easter Sunday, that glorious event marked by inexpressible joy, celebration, and gratitude. Mark Lawbranson and Alan Roxburgh in Leadership, God's Agency and Disruptions, and don't we have that in the world today, disruptions, tell us that metaphors are pre-critical, functioning as assumed, taken for granted ways of reading our world. They're established in our culture and they're generally not questioned. They come to express a culture's tacit values about a people's place in the world and what it means to be human, to be in relationship with one another and to form structures for political, familial and religious life. And they express a group's assumptions about how the world works. And the kinds of habits, practices, attitudes, and values that are to shape and sustain our relationships and organisations. So the metaphor is pretty significant. They express the nature of the group's commitments. They provide ways for people to behave within a group, and they communicate its traditions to one another. They're hardly about individuals. This story of the blind beggar is a metaphor of the outcast, the undesirable, the untouchable in society. Yet this story, with such a powerful metaphor of the distinction between systemic injustice and the underlying assumptions of structures of power differentials, is smashed by Jesus and is replaced by a radical upside-down kingdom metaphor that disrupts and ultimately transforms the surrounding group's culture. It's a powerful story. The story is contained in Luke chapter 18, and the author of Luke wants to reinforce the virtues or the values of this new upside-down kingdom. And you'll recall in Luke chapter 4, Jesus enters a synagogue, is handed a scroll, he unrolls it, and the scripture is from Isaiah 61. And it says this, just to remind you, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour." And then he rolls up the scroll and sits down, and all the eyes of the synagogue are on him, and he says this, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." So chapter 18 commences with the parable of the persistent widow. And persistence, we understand, is a virtue of the kingdom. We have to persist. But she is also poor and she's widowed. She's invisible, but she appeals to those in power. And it continues with the contrasting and systemic injustice of those with power, the Pharisees and the tax collector. Probably one of the most despised metaphors for the kingdom. These characters continue to be metaphors of a power differential, with the virtue that's expected of kingdom, which is repentance, lament, humility. And we can read that in the two stories preceding this one. And then the author shows the posture and attitude of those who would choose life, which is the overarching intention of our Lenten series. And astoundingly, it's little children. These characters are metaphors that show us how we are to posture ourselves, our attitudes, in order to gain the kingdom in our lives. And lastly, the author profiles the rich ruler, who is unable to give up his worldly wealth to follow Jesus. He has surrendered to Mammon and not to God. And then the story continues with the greatest surrender of all, when Jesus declares to his disciples what is going to happen when he goes to Jerusalem, and the Good Friday story of his death, or his surrender on a cross. And so this all leads into today's story, which is about a beggar. And immediately what we hear is that this man has no name. He is labelled. He's a beggar. And what we know is that labels dehumanise us. Some of you might know, but growing up, I have the fortune and misfortune of being an identical triplet. And growing up, I was labelled. I was labelled triplet. I was labelled trip. Or if people were a little bit more intimate, they would ask me, "Which one are you?" Like I was an object, not a person. Invariably, if they had a stab at my name, I would get the name of one of my triplet sisters. So I grew up with this sense of who am I? My identity was connected to my name. My humanity was connected to my name. And this beggar is not named. He is dehumanized. So we hear other labels, don't we, like prostitute, beggar, very applicable at the moment, Muslim, leper, widow. These are all labels that dehumanise people. But this man was not only a beggar, he was homeless, and possibly through no fault of his own. He was not only a homeless beggar, but he was blind, as Nigel so dramatically demonstrated. He was totally at the mercy of those who were privileged, those who had sight, those who could work, those who had a home, those who had family and community. In biblical times, if you had some disease or impediment, it was thought that either you or your parents had sinned. You were shunned. You were shunned, you were marginalised, and you were labelled. And it's probable because this man was begging that he had no familial connections. He was not only a beggar, homeless, and blind, but he was also completely alone and destitute. And so today, I'm entitling this sermon, The Gift of Lament and Gratitude. As we will see, that this extremely disadvantaged human being, whose name we don't know, really saw Jesus. And his life was transformed. And so in this story today, we want to give the beggar a name. We'll call him Nigel. Is that okay, Nigel? Okay. And in doing so, we too want to be transformed. And the beggar can teach us how. So the scriptures say, as Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard the crowd going by, he asked what was happening, and they told him, Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. And he called out, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Here we see a metaphor for blindness, but it's the blindness of the crowd. It's not just a physical blindness, it's a spiritual blindness. The people refused to afford to Jesus his right title. He was just a man, albeit an extraordinary man, but he was from Nazareth. And we know nothing good can come from Nazareth. Yet the blind man calls Jesus by his correct title. He sees Jesus. Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. The Messiah was to come from the house of David. So the scriptures go on to say, those who led the way rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. And here we hear a lament, a cry from the depths of his spirit. Have mercy on me. And the crowd's response, what right does this man have to be part of the approved or sanctioned ones in the culture? After all, a metaphor is actually the assumptions, the underlying ways we assume how the world works. And his situation reinforces our privilege. Take that away, and we are like the beggar. So this cry of lament is actually a cry or a prayer. It's just that we are told that Jesus then stops and he orders the man to be brought to him. And I love that, because actually when Jesus does that, when he turns, I almost imagine in the story that Jesus is turning his back on the privileged and actually attending to the invisible one. And when we are listened to, or when we really listen to others, we humanize ourselves in the best possible way. In The Listening Life, Adam McHugh says, my dream for the church is that we would be known as a listening community. Our listening would be multi-directional, with one ear turned out and one ear turned in. Our listening would be just as much a part of our mission as our pastoral care and our church governance. And Jesus says to the man, pretty incredibly, what do you want me to do for you? And I love that, because actually Jesus is not making any assumptions about that man's need. I mean, my assumption would be, of course, he'd want to see. Because to be able to see becomes part of the privileged collective. You can work, you can enjoy your family. Why wouldn't he want to see? And as it turns out, that's how he answers Jesus. But I think that question is one of the most crucial in all scripture. Imagine if over the centuries, we of the entitled, we of the superior, went into the mission fields or our churches, our society, and first asked this question without assuming what the other needs. It may be obvious to us that this man wanted to see, but our assumptions come from a place of entitlement. Warren and I lived in Wodonga for about 20 years and attended Wodonga Baptist Church, and I had a friend who was blind, completely blind from birth. She contracted cancer of the eyes as a baby. And in those years, there was nothing they could do. Maybe they could do something these days. And she was able to marry. She had children. And she kept a home. She also volunteered in the church. She was part of a prayer team. She was part of a women's leadership group. But I marveled because one day, her and her husband went across to Ireland for a holiday. And when she came back, she was enthusiastic about what she saw. She said, "Ireland is just so magnificent. It's so green, it's so verdant, it's so lush." And I was too reticent to ask her, "How do you know this? You're blind." And maybe the blind can teach us something about the wider work of God in our lives. The way we can perceive, the way we can act, the way we can love, the way perhaps a sense, another sense is increased or scaled up. And there's beauty in that. So the assumptions that we carry, we need to first ask, "What do you want from me?" Mary Clark Michella, quoting Dietrich Bonhoeffer in Life Together, says, "The first service that one owes to others in the fellowship consists in listening to them. Just as love of God begins with listening to his word, so the beginning of love for the brethren is learning to listen to them." Listening to your stories, listening to your life, getting to know one another, deepening that sense of community. And so the story goes on, and Jesus heals him miraculously. And we heard this morning about the gift of oil, the healing power of God. And what's interesting is the scripture winds up with this verse, "Immediately." Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus, praising God. Marcus Tullius Cicero, I'm sure you've all heard of him, lived some 2,000 years ago, and he was a Roman philosopher and statesman, and he said this: "Gratitude is not only the greatest of virtues, but the parent of all others." Another word for thanksgiving is gratitude, the gift of gratitude. The word comes from the Latin gratis, which means grace or graciousness. And in the Greek, it means charis, where we get the word eucharista from. We give thanks to God with gratitude for Jesus. But gratitude is not just a virtue. It can become a posture for life. It can become a way of life if we practice it. And I have to admit, since I've been thinking about this message, I've probably been checking in my spirit of how grateful am I? Because I so easily spiral into a place of ingratitude. No, I don't want to get up today and go to work. I want to go off on a caravan like people in my era are doing. No, Lord, I'm just tired. And do I really have to be present and listening to this person when no one listens to me? So gratitude is a posture for life. And the opposite of gratitude is ingratitude. And Lord Branson in the book Memories says, the absence of gratitude is a primary sign that persons have turned away from God, that God's presence and initiatives are being rejected. Gratitude is a spiritual discipline, as is lament. If we combine both those spiritual disciplines of lamenting, our own personal complicity in the world to injustice, if we lament of that, if we lament of our privilege, our taken for granted gifts, and then if we don't adopt the virtue of gratitude, we live poorer lives. We live reduced lives. A couple of weeks ago, Warren Martin recognised this, but I was feeling annoyed with him. And anyway, I thought he was asking me a question and it was just interrupting my activity and my thoughts. And I thought, I'm going to adopt this virtue of gratitude instead. So you didn't notice, honey, did you? And so I did. And I said, oh no, I'm fine. How are you? And what I realized is that posture and that virtue actually shifts the whole culture, the whole atmosphere. He didn't spiral down into a concern for me or, you know, a place of, oh, woe me, I've got this wife that's complaining. You know, it actually enhanced the atmosphere. But it's a discipline. It's a discipline. And gratitude is a response to God for what he has given us. It's a response to others for who they are. And it's vital to sustaining communities that are holy and good. Karl Barth wrote several centuries later from Cicero that God's work in our lives makes each of us a new creature, and that this new creature is grateful. It knows God and itself becomes a new creature by being thankful. To believe in Jesus Christ means to be thankful. And so we have this metaphor of an outcast person who, through Jesus's healing and Jesus's concern and attention to listening and respecting him and humanizing him, becomes part again of the community that first ostracized him. But he is thankful. And the final comment I want to make is at the end of this verse, when all the people saw it, they also praised God. Gratitude is infectious. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for the gift of lament and the gift of gratitude. Thank you, Lord, that you invite us into that place where you show us the kingdom values, the kingdom metaphors, where you usurp the underlying assumptions of the powerful and instead call us to adopt the metaphors of the kingdom. Thank you, Jesus, that we are privileged to partake in this with you, Lord Jesus, who modeled more than any other human being what it means to be human. We pray that we too can adopt this spiritual gift and practice it In your holy name, amen.
Gail, thank you. We are grateful. As we prepare to share together communion, I invite you to sing with me, A Place at the Table. Would you stand? Sundays ago, we had a members' meeting here at Collins Street, and we were delighted to receive applications for membership from some new members of our community. It happens that over the last couple of years, through the experiences of lockdown and isolation, we have welcomed a number of people into membership of our church, and yet have had few opportunities to actually formally say to those people at a service of communion, how very much we appreciate them and welcome them into the membership of the church. So added to the three that we accepted into membership from last Sunday, there are others who are going to come and join me at the front now. So I'm going to ask Viv and Marilyn, and I'm going to ask Ben, Robin and Marilyn, and David Morgan, and David Cundy. And they're all going to come and stand nice and close to me and not stand too far away. That would be wonderful. Now, there are some who are a part of this group. That is people that we are welcoming into membership that can't be here today. Judy Morgan has come down with some symptoms and we are feeling for her this morning. And Cheryl and Lee Reeves were trying to get here on the tram this morning from Docklands, but were thwarted by some sort of marathon, I think. And so they can't be with us. And then Kate Eve and Chris Turner are unable to be with us this morning, and we will welcome those folks in at the very first opportunity that we find. But I wanted to say to each of you this morning how delighted we are today to welcome you into the membership of the church. David Cundy, you recognise him, sits at the organ. He came to us initially on an interim basis to assist us with the music. He has now found a spiritual home at Collins Street. And David was baptised in the Presbyterian Church and confirmed as a teenager in the Anglican tradition. He is partnered with an RCO and only this year was formally appointed our lead musician for the next season of the church's life. Now, Robin and Marilyn Winter. Robin and Marilyn came to us originally from the Uniting Church of Bairnsdale in the East Gippsland of Victoria. It was in Bairnsdale that they lived, raised a family, and worked, I think, for more than 40 years. Is that right? You don't look old enough. They're now resident in East Melbourne, and they have become valued members of our church family. David Morgan, along with Judy, who's not here, began attending at Collins Street on their move from Roval to Kensington after many years of fellowship at the City Life Church in Waverley. They are both involved in tertiary education and have both already made a significant contribution to the life of our church. So to you today, David, and to Judy next time, we say welcome. Ben Verghese has also been with us for the last 6 years. Ben was raised in the Marthoma tradition in Malaysia. He came to a more personal experience of faith here in Australia back in his university days, just a couple of years ago. In the years past, Ben has been part of Uniting and Anglican communities, but he's now found a home with us, and we are so very glad. Now, Viv, right here. Vivian Pye was baptised as an infant in the Anglican Church. Later in life, Viv came to a personal faith and was baptised by immersion at the Camberwell Baptist Church. Was that back in the 70s, Viv? A little while ago. She's attended Baptist churches ever since then. She has studied at Whitley College and began attending at Collins Street in 2020. Am I right? Excellent. And then finally, Marilyn Hickson. Marilyn was baptised as a teenager at the North Baldwin Baptist Church, where I think her parents were both life deacons. Is that correct? My word. Marilyn is a mother and a grandmother and a basket weaver of note. You'll have to ask her about that. Having spent many years in Benalla in northeastern Victoria, Marilyn has come home to Melbourne and has subsequently found her way to us, and we are so very glad. Have I missed anyone? I haven't. Through their commitment to membership, these people are living their baptism. They are declaring personally and publicly their belonging in the body of Christ and to this household of faith at Collins Street. Committed to growing in their faith and exercising their gifts for the good of the church, they are saying today, it is in this community and among these people that they will seek to follow Jesus and make their contribution to the work of God in the world. And in return, we are saying we will support you, encourage you, cheer you on, and walk with you as we follow Jesus together. So, Having said all of those things, let me take this microphone and make my way all the way down to the end. Ben, upon your profession of faith, your baptism, and your commitment to this church, we affirm you today as a person gifted and called to ministry. We welcome you into the membership of the Collins Street Baptist Church. Robin, hold my hand. Upon your profession of faith, upon your baptism and your commitment to this church, we affirm you today as a person gifted and called to ministry. We welcome you into the membership of the Collins Street Baptist Church. Marilyn, upon your profession of faith, upon your baptism and your commitment to this church, we affirm you today as a person gifted and called to ministry. We welcome you into the membership of the Collins Street Baptist Church. Bless you. David, upon your profession of faith, your baptism and your commitment to the church, we affirm you today as a person gifted and called to ministry. We welcome you into the membership of the Collins Street Baptist Church. Bless you. Marilyn, upon your profession of faith, your baptism and your commitment to the church, we affirm you today as a person gifted and called to ministry. And we welcome you into the membership of the Collins Street Baptist Church. David Cundy, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, your baptism and your commitment to us at Collins Street, we affirm you today as a person gifted and called to ministry. We welcome you into the membership of the Collins Street Baptist Church. Vivian, last but not least, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, your baptism and your commitment to the people of God, we affirm you today as a person gifted and called to ministry. We welcome you into the membership of the Collins Street Baptist Church. Bless you. Would you stand together as we pray for these people? Our loving God, we give you thanks for the gift that each of these people represent, the wonderful gift of your Spirit that resides within their lives, that has carried them and called them to this point. We pray, dear God, that as they invest deeply in their relationship with you and their relationship with the people of God, that they will be strengthened, that they will be ever more deeply called into the grace and the courage of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Fill them with your Spirit, and we bless them in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now, before you sit down, we together are going to speak some words of blessing to you. You don't have to say a thing, but we're going to speak to you, and you'll see the words that are up on the screen. We say these words together. And now, may you be strong to grasp with all God's people what is the breadth and length and height and depth of the love of Christ. May you know that love, and may you live in the fullness and the calling of God every day of your life. Amen. Peace to you. You can now sit back down. And now, as the body of Christ, we gather at this table that defines and calls us as the followers of Jesus. It is the table that Jesus laid and invited each of us to, a table of memory, a table of grace, and a table of welcome. And so I welcome you to this table today, whoever you are, whatever your story, whatever your cultural background, your tradition, wherever you've been, however you feel about yourself, you are welcome here. I invite you now into some moments of quietness as we acknowledge that God is with us at this table. A moment too to invite the Spirit of God to come and cleanse and renew and forgive you as you meet at this table today. So let us sit for a few moments of quietness, aware of God's grace with us just now. On the night before his death, Jesus met with his followers in a quiet room. He cemented his relationship with them through a meal that began with bread and ended with wine. At the beginning of the meal, he took the bread that was on the table and he broke it and said, "This is my body given for you. Take, eat, and as you do, remember me." In the same way, at the end of the meal, Jesus took the cup that was on the table and he said to his followers, "This is my blood, my covenant love, shed for you, that invites you in to a lifetime of grace. Drink. And as you do, remember me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Our stewards will be standing at the base of the two aisles. Over here will be the bread, and we ask that when you're ready, that you would come down this aisle, receive the bread and eat it as you receive it. And then if you would make your way across to this side and receive the wine, take it back to your seat that we might drink together as the people of God. The invitation is open. Come whenever you are ready. you stand with me? We are the people of God. We are made new and made whole in the sacrificial love of Jesus Christ. We drink together with the deepest gratitude. Our loving God, fill us by your Spirit, that we would go forth from this place, living and breathing the healing of God for the world. Lead us forth in joy, in gratitude, and determination. For this we pray in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Would you remain standing as we sing our final hymn, Here I Am, Lord. Of this beautiful space to my right and your left, a place to sit quietly and reflect, or whenever you're ready to join us for a cup of tea and perhaps something a little extra, we would love to have your company there. My brothers and sisters, the people of God, may you go from this place deeply aware of the mercy of God in your life and determined and renewed to take that mercy, live it and breathe it at every opportunity. So go with the calling of Jesus upon your life and go in peace. Amen.